What is going on, Catella APUSH Nation? Mr. Majewski, I hope that you will remember all of the centuries of the colonial American era, because we got a test on this on Monday and we need to move through this material quickly. So let's get started right away. We're going to start with question number one, obviously. How did European slave traders acquire their cargo, and what were the conditions aboard the slave ships? What were slave codes? All right, well, we know European slave traders acquired their cargo from African tribes. West African tribes captured prisoners during battle, sold them to European slave traders aboard something that becomes known as the Atlantic slave trade, also sometimes referred to as the Middle Passage. Originally, remember, it was the Portuguese, and then the Dutch, and then the British took over the slave industry, and for lack of a better term, what were the conditions aboard the slave ships? Remember, they were horrific. You read two primary sources about that. I don't need to go into much detail about the agony, the mistreatment, the horror aboard those ships. What were slave codes? Slave codes were laws that were passed in colonial America in order to regulate and control African slaves, to deny them privileges, to deny them rights. Number two, who were the founders, leaders, and initial settlers of each of the British American colonies? And which nations were the individual groups that settled in each colony from? For what purpose was each colony initially founded? Well, folks, I'm going to go directly to a slide that I'm going to be giving all of you. First off, can we spell purpose correctly? This kind of gives it to you right here. It gives you the name of the colony. It gives you the reason why it was founded. It gives you the date in which they were founded. They actually are kind of in order, I guess you could say. It tells you the founder, and it also tells you the major export that was produced in that particular colony as well. I'm not going to spend much time on this just because I'm going to give this to you. I'm going to print it out for you as well. I wouldn't say you have to know every single colony, but obviously I'm going to tell you, you need to know Virginia and the Chesapeake, which would include Maryland. You need to know Plymouth and Massachusetts Bay, obviously. You obviously need to know, New York. You need to know Rhode Island, Pennsylvania, right? So New York, Rhode Island, Pennsylvania. Maryland, obviously, as part of the Chesapeake with Virginia, although founded for a very different reason. And finally, you should know the Carolinas and Georgia. I would say South Carolina much more significant if you are working on remembering these things. Other than that, the other colonies you can really just gloss over. There'll be no questions about them whatsoever, not only on my exam, but also on the APUSH exam come May. So number two, the chart helps. I'm going to print that out for everybody so they get a copy themselves. It's an excellent little reminder for you. Number three, which colonies supported greater political and or religious freedoms, and which colonies denied them to settlers the most? Well, the most democratic colonies were generally considered to be, first off, politically democratic. We're going to start in Massachusetts Bay and Plymouth. Remember, the town hall meetings are a good example of that. Let's remember the Mayflower Compact as well. So those are all, generally considered to be pretty democratic places. So is Rhode Island, for that matter. So if we're going to lump Plymouth and Massachusetts Bay together, Rhode Island belongs there as well. It was also very democratic. Remember, all free men had the right to vote there. Which was even more democratic than existed in Massachusetts Bay and Plymouth, where only male church members, if you remember, had the right to vote. Other politically free places, Pennsylvania, remember, also granted the right to vote to any free male as well. Virginia was considered somewhat democratic in that it had the House of Burgesses, but we need to remember that it was actually aristocrats who really dominated there. So while they were democratic compared to many other places around the world, it was still really the wealthy parts of society that were still in charge. All right. Religiously free? Well, religious freedom really existed for the most part in Pennsylvania and Rhode Island. Again, for the same reasons. Remember, neither of them had an established church. Rhode Island, remember, was established by Roger Williams, who was critical of Massachusetts for its strict religious rules. Pennsylvania, established by the Quakers. So for the same reason, they too were very religiously free. We should also mention Maryland. Remember, Maryland had the famous Act of Toleration, another example of religious freedom, that said basically all Christians could worship or practice freely. So those are generally considered to be the three religiously free colonies. Sometimes they overlapped with political freedom, as was the case with Pennsylvania and Rhode Island. Sometimes they didn't. And a good example of that, again, is Massachusetts Bay. Number four, be sure to know how each event contributed to emerging democracy and or unity in the colonies. Obviously, democracy is going to be our system of government when the U.S. is created. So we like to trace back to where it all began in the American colonies. And the answer is, it started very early. First, the House of Burgesses, 1619. It's a colonial assembly, which means the colonists are electing people to represent themselves and to make some decisions for themselves outside the power of the king. The House of Burgesses was run by aristocrats, but they were elected. And again, they are making some decisions for themselves by vote. That, by its very nature, is democratic. The Virginia Charter as well. What the Virginia Charter was something that said, hey, all Englishmen that come over to the colonies, to the Virginia colony, have the exact same rights as Englishmen back in England do. So again, trying to maintain the idea that these folks are going to maintain the same rights that they might have otherwise had in England. And they're not going to lose any of them simply by leaving the country to come to the colonies. The Mayflower Compact, it was simple. It was something signed by the Pilgrims at Plymouth, and all it really said was rule by the majority. So they're going to follow majority rule, they're going to take votes on key issues, and if the majority wins, whatever majority wins, that would be the rule or the law of the land. Town hall meetings. Town hall meetings, remember, were popular in Plymouth. They were also popular in Massachusetts Bay. They are an example of where a town would get together and they would speak and talk about major issues, and then they would vote on them, or at least the male members would vote on them. So it's an early example of democracy, one of the most obvious examples, because literally people in each town are making decisions for themselves and how to run their political affairs. Maryland's Act of Toleration is an example of religious freedom. Again, it said all Christians can practice freely within the colony of Maryland. Obviously, as you remember from some of the videos we watched, non-Christians did not have that benefit. The Fundamental Orders of Connecticut, this is probably the only thing you ever need to know from Connecticut. The Fundamental Orders were our first constitution. A constitution is a system of government that's written down where the laws and decisions will be made based on written law. The very first one was in Connecticut. Later on, obviously, we have a constitution that runs the United States, and so we like to look back and see where the first example of that existed. New York Chapter of Liberties, again, was something that was created by the New York colony to try to protect individual liberties. It was really used as a recruitment tool. It's not considered as important, but because it wrote down certain liberties that ought to be respected or protected, it is considered an early example as well. Very similar to what's going to be our Bill of Rights later on. The New England Confederation and the Dominion of New England are early examples of colonial unity. Again, later on, this country is going to exist, and the states are going to come together to form this country. And so we like to look back and see where the earliest examples of unity were. New England Confederation was a military confederation of New England against Native Americans. It was kind of used at the end of the Pequot War, but it was much more famous for its use during King Philip's War. The colonists didn't often agree on a lot. Colonies were oftentimes rivals with one another. And so to have an early example of unity here is actually kind of significant. That's why we remember it. It's one of the very first examples of colonies working together for a common interest. Unfortunately for the natives, the common interest was their destruction and removal. Dominion of New England, remember, is when the king sent over a person named Edmund Andros to try to kind of take over New England and run it on behalf of the king. He was worried that the Puritan church was getting too powerful and that Massachusetts, this colony, had grown to be too powerful as well. And so he sends Andros over. Andros attempts to unify the colonies, If you recall, ultimately, the colonists reject this and send Andros home. Again, another early example of unity, this time against the King of England and his agent, Edmund Andros. So all of those good examples of early democracy in the colonies. 5, in what colonial region was education more valued? And how was education different between the three regions? Okay. Education was more valued in New England. So it was most valued in New England, then the middle colonies, and then it was least valued in the southern colonies. How was it different between the regions? Well, remember, in New England, they had public school in almost every town, every city. Remember, the rule was, if you had more than 50 families, you had to build a school with taxpayer money and all children were educated. The goal was to create an educated population in order to read the Bible, to read the Word of God. The middle colonies were less educated than New England, but they were more educated than the South. The middle colonies basically were kind of a mixture of schools, generally not tax supported or paid for by taxpayer money. There were some schools that existed, usually private. A lot of times, wealthy individuals might be able to send their students, their kids, to maybe England or other places in order to study as well. The South education system really didn't exist. That's because the South had few towns, few cities, and so therefore there were very few places where there were enough people, I guess you could say, to support a school. Also, education wasn't as valued there because, remember, a lot of the folks were originally coming in order to work. So the only education that really took place in the South generally was for the very wealthy aristocratic families, the children of those families. Oftentimes that was done with private tutors that were brought in and hired in order to teach, or potentially like a female in the family, like a mom or a grandmother might give basic education. The big differences here, especially in the middle colonies and the South, are that boys were generally educated more, girls not as much. In New England, education was for both sexes, since both of them would obviously be church members and reading the Bible. 6, and oh, by the way, the second part of that, what were some of the academic institutions of higher learning founded in the 17th century, and for what purposes? So obviously, almost all of the major colleges that existed were located in New England, and we're talking about a lot of what we call the Ivy League schools, right? We're talking about Harvard, Yale, Princeton. The first law school, the Massachusetts Institute of Law, was created there as well. So these schools were clustered in New England, and that makes sense. It was much more educated. It was much more literate. Remember, many of these early schools were founded in order to teach ministers to spread the word of God to future generations. Now, there were a handful of colleges and universities outside of New England, but that's where almost all of them were clustered, and that's what we kind of associate that region with. 6, in what parts of the colonies were religions most important? In which parts of the colonies was religion more important in the 17th century? What churches were established during this time? What places had no established church? Okay. So religion was most important, obviously, as you might expect, in New England. Religion was a part of everyday life with the Puritan or Congregational Church, and so it had just massive, massive control over everyday life. Church membership was a must, right? If you really wanted to succeed and have all the rights and benefits, church attendance was almost an absolute necessity every single day. In the rest of the colonies, the church religion generally wasn't as important, I guess you could say. Obviously, Maryland with Catholics had a lot of Catholics there. Obviously, Pennsylvania had a lot of Quakers there. But all in all, the church did not have as much control in either of those two places. Most of the southern colonies and also New York were technically run or were dominated by the Anglican Church, but the Anglican Church was never powerful in the colonies. It was a church made up of aristocrats and wealthy nobles back in England and the King of England. Since they were never very numerous in the colonies, they generally were not nearly as powerful as, for instance, the Puritan Church was in New England. They existed. They were the strongest in many colonies, especially the southern ones, but again, they just didn't have that hold over everyday life. What churches were established during this time and in which regions? Established church in New England, for the most part, was the Puritan Church, right? With the exception of Rhode Island, where there wasn't one, because Roger Williams criticized the Puritan Church for doing that. In the middle colonies, there were generally, in New York, the Anglican Church was established. Elsewhere throughout the middle colonies, there was none, because again, the Quakers did not believe in an established church. And then in the South, the Anglican Church was generally established, which meant tax-supported. By the way, established meant that every person that lived there pays taxes to it, whether they're a member of that church or not. So again, in the South, it's the Anglican. In New England, it's the Congregational. And then generally speaking, throughout the Middle Colonies and in Rhode Island, you really did not see an established church. Seven are the basics associated with the Puritan and the Quakers. Remember, Puritans, very strict religious group. They live in groups with one another. They're the ones, obviously, that migrate to New England. The church was based on Calvinism back in Europe. It's very strict. God is all-powerful. Humans are weak and sinful. Remember, they believe in predestination. And so your goal is to basically get a sign from God that you are going to heaven. Of course, you were supposed to live a very noble, sacred life to get the message from God and to be a moral guide for the rest of your fellow Puritans. They were strict. They were harsh. They did not allow for a lot of toleration. They did not want people questioning. They wore very like dark clothing. You weren't supposed to stand out. You were supposed to be a member of the group, and you were supposed to be very devout with a very literal interpretation of the Bible. The other major religious group in the colonies was the Quakers. Remember, the Quakers were clustered in Pennsylvania, but they were really spread throughout most of the middle colonies. They had been persecuted by the Puritans. They also were persecuted by the Anglican Church back in England, for that matter, so were the Puritans. They settled in Pennsylvania. Remember, they believed everybody had an inner light, so that you shouldn't, treat people poorly, I guess you could say, even Native Americans. They did not believe in forced worship. They didn't believe in military service. They didn't take oaths of allegiance, to kings or other groups. So they were kind of, live and let live in a lot of ways. Number eight, what was the plantation system? I think we know what that is. That's an agricultural system, where large farms, where forced labor was used on large farms. Originally, it was indentured servants in some parts of the South. Eventually, it becomes replaced by African slaves. The plantation system was very popular where cash crops were popular, where they could grow. So generally, in the Southern colonies, because that's where we saw plantation styles the most, the weather, the climate, the terrain, the soil, all of that supported plantation agriculture, and so therefore they wanted large numbers of workers who could work that land in order to grow as many cash crops as possible and to make the most profit to send back to England. We know who indentured servants were. They were English migrants who were essentially forced to pay for the cost of transportation over to the colonies. Oftentimes that meant 5 to 7 years. They signed a contract. They'll work on the plantation when their time is up. Oftentimes they were then called, they were called free men or freedmen, and they were supposed to be given land and be able to start their own farm afterwards. The headright system was a system, remember, that gave 50 acres of land to every plantation owner for bringing an indentured servant over. It leads to plantation owners becoming wealthier, owning more land, becoming more powerful, and maybe not treating their indentured servants as well as they otherwise would have. What was Bacon's Rebellion? Remember, that was a rebellion that occurred by indentured servants and free men who were frustrated. They were frustrated that there wasn't enough land available, that many of them were not being very successful. Many were dying before they were even becoming free men. Remember, they wanted to move into the interior, but there were Indians there, and they blamed their own government for not doing a lot. So a guy named Nathaniel Bacon led a rebellion against the colonial government of Virginia. Obviously, it ends up being unsuccessful, but of course, because of that, plantation owners decide, you know what, we need to switch over to African slaves because we think they're more reliable, we think they're more controllable, and so we start to see the massive change from slaves, from indentured servants to slaves after that. Number nine, describe the relationship between Europeans and natives in the British American colonies. Be sure to focus on Thanksgiving. Well, Thanksgiving is a great example of how things started out well. That was in Plymouth, obviously. The original separatists called the Pilgrims show up. They depend on the natives for assistance in terms of agriculture, in terms of food. They celebrate their alliance that they form with the local Wampanoag tribe. by having famous feasts, right, at the end of certain growing seasons. And of course, Thanksgiving is the most famous of those that we celebrate today. In addition to that, we get into the bad stuff. Shortly after Thanksgiving celebrations, the relationship started to get worse in New England. This was especially after Plymouth becomes less important and Massachusetts Bay becomes more, because the Massachusetts Bay folks were much larger, they needed more land, and so they came into conflict more with the natives in the area as they went onto land that the natives considered to be theirs. There are two conflicts. Remember the Pequot and the King Philip's War in New England. What happens there is, as a result of both of those wars, the Native Americans are slowly wiped out. And eventually, after King Philip's War, if they weren't wiped out completely, they were removed either by choice or by force, so that there were essentially no more Native Americans in New England following those two conflicts. Pequot Wars in the 1640s, King Philip's War in the 1670s. So already, by the 1670s, New England's pretty much clear of most Native tribes. And therefore, Puritans and other English people can move into that area more freely. We go down to the Chesapeake. And remember, there were two conflicts between the Virginia colonists and the local Indian tribes called the Powhatans. There were two different wars, one in the 1610s, late 1610s, early 1620s. The other happened in about the 1640s, early 1640s. These were two different conflicts, again, because Europeans in Virginia, English people, were moving further and further inland. And as they did, it led to natural conflict with natives. There was also some disputes over food and things along those lines as well. And so, of course, again, the result is really the destruction of the Powhatan. They are removed, and they choose really to just leave the area rather than have to suffer from more onslaught from the English people afterwards. Carolina Indian slavery. Remember, one of the very first things when Carolina was founded is that the local Barbados migrants, the folks that had come over from Barbados, they were English. But they had come from the West Indies. They rounded up the local natives, and then they sold them off into slavery in the Caribbean. Probably not a surprise when we know the reasons why that colony was founded. Indian raids on Carolina from Florida. Remember, one of the things that Florida did, what the Spanish did in Florida, is that they encouraged Indian attacks on Carolina. They would pay for them. They would supply the natives with weapons. And, of course, the goal was to try to slow down the spread of the British colonies, especially Carolina, so that the Spanish wouldn't be as threatened, wouldn't be as fearful that they would be overrun and overwhelmed in the future. The Iroquois Confederacy is the famous alliance that existed between England and Native tribes up in the eastern woodlands, right around the New York and Pennsylvania area. The Iroquois were powerful. They formed an alliance with the English. Of course, their rivals, the Huron, ended up forming alliances with the French because of the natural rivalry that existed between those two European countries. Pennsylvania obviously becomes known as a place that's a safe haven for Native Americans, especially when the Quakers were in charge. Natives were allowed to live there. They did not carry weapons around, as was the case almost everywhere else. And this had to do with the fact, again, that the Quakers felt like all people had an inner light, even Native Americans, and so they treated them more fairly. Please remember that as time goes by, more non-Quakers come into the colony, and that does lead to more conflict with Native tribes. Number 10, how did the role of women change in New England during the 17th century? In what ways were women still treated as secondary citizens in colonial life? Well, one, in New England in particular, women become more significant in the church as time goes by. Now, I don't mean they become like powerful people in the church. They make up more and more of the membership. This is especially the case as we get into the late 1600s, as the church starts to lose a little of its power, and I'm talking about the Puritan church. As it loses its control, its influence, its power, one thing that was noticed was more women were attending than men for the first time. They held on to their beliefs, I guess you could say, longer. But women were always secondary or subservient to men, no matter where you were. They could not own land. They could not vote in almost anywhere. In fact, anywhere they couldn't vote. They were rarely allowed to speak politically. They were not allowed to be members of the ministry. And so generally speaking, women were incredibly subservient. They were forced to live a really second-class existence. They were denied the same rights as men. They were denied the same opportunities as men. They couldn't, like, for instance, be a part of any jury. They could not sue anybody. In many places, they weren't even allowed to own land whatsoever. 11, identify similarities and differences between the separatists and non-separatists. Well, the similarity is they believe the same thing. They're both Puritans. They both believe in the same religious beliefs. The biggest differences are that when they come, remember the non-separatists, the Puritans stayed in England longer. They wanted to try to purify or clean up and reform the church, the Anglican church that was there. The separatists, the pilgrims, left right away. And ultimately, they both end up over in New England, right next to each other. And that makes a lot of sense because, again, they were pretty much the exact same religious people. How was each colony in New England an offshoot of these people? Well, Plymouth was founded by the separatists, Massachusetts Bay by the non-separatists. They eventually spread into the rest of New England just by natural spreading as more people came. One of the things they did, remember, was they had a lot of large families, and so those families quickly spread into surrounding areas and new colonies were formed. Even Rhode Island was an offshoot of Massachusetts because it was founded by somebody who was critical of and got booted out or excommunicated, and that was Roger Williams. Number 12, how did Jeremiads, the Halfway Covenant, and Salem Witch Trials begin to demonstrate cracks in the Puritan Church? Jeremiads, remember, were fiery speeches that were designed to try to almost shame or use emotion to convince Puritans to become religious again. This was something that was proposed as the church felt like they were losing membership and they were losing control over everyday life in Massachusetts. The Halfway Covenant, remember, was something that lowered the rules. Again, the church was really bothered by the fact that fewer and fewer people were becoming members over time. And so the Halfway Covenant lowered the rules to become a member. You didn't have to have the conversion experience as long as one of your parents had. The Salem Witch Trials, remember, were used by the Puritan Church. The fear that was occurring here, that there were witches and possessed people, was used by the church almost to try to scare or intimidate folks into coming back to the church again. Folks, all of these things are signs the church recognizes they're losing their influence, they're losing control, and so this is their reaction to them. What did the Cambridge Platform try to do? Remember, it tried to standardize or unify the message that all Puritan churches had. You need to remember Puritan churches, each church in each town, the minister really had control over the messages. So the Cambridge Platform tried to make it where the church could control the messages more to make sure that criticism was not getting out about them as they become more concerned. Again, they're losing influence in New England. 13, what other colonist rebels occurred in the 16 and early 1700s other than Bacon's Rebellion? What were their causes and outcomes? All right, well, Leisler's Rebellion in New York, it was almost the exact same thing. Remember, it was landless migrants in New York, English and Dutch folks who were upset that land was not available because wealthy aristocrats controlled most of it. They rose up in opposition to the colonial government. They were defeated. Obviously, same as Bacon's Rebellion. Another rebellion occurred in Maryland. Protestants that were living amongst Catholics. The Catholics controlled the big plantations. The Catholics had all the land. There were a lot of small Protestant farmers who decided to rise up and try to overthrow the Catholic government there as well. Again, it was not successful. So what you're seeing here is most of the early rebellions were about a lack of opportunity for frustrated poor people, especially landless people. And so they would attack the government. They might also attack Native Americans as well, if you recall, for maybe preventing or slowing down their spread inland. None of them are successful. And they're, again, signs of maybe growing frustration with by landless or poor people, with wealthy aristocrats and governments that protected them. 14, what demographic population changes occurred in 18th century? So we're moving into the 18th century now. And these are the notes that we've covered or will cover Thursday and Friday before the exam takes place on Monday. Population change, one, the population skyrocketed in the 18th century. It got much larger. More and more people are coming. And we start to see more natural childbirth as well. Places like Virginia, which previously had lost a lot of people, balance out and start to grow pretty quickly. So population booms, and we see more folks not only migrating than ever before, but we're going to start to see a lot more natural childbirth. And so the population quickly goes into the millions after just having a few thousand people there about 100 years before. What were the most important money-making economic activities in each region? How did this change between the 17th and 18th? Well, I showed you that chart before. I'm going to go back to it again. Tells you the most important economic activities here. Now, the one thing that I would mention is, as the colonies develop into the 18th century, a lot of these industries become more diverse. What I mean is, Plymouth, especially like the cash crop stayed cash crop, but like Plymouth and eventually Massachusetts, even New York, a lot of New England and the middle colonies, they become much more diverse, which means they're making their money in more ways. Shipping, lumber, ship building, right? Furs, of course, were still around. A lot of grain in the middle colonies, a lot of subsistence farming where you're growing for your own needs in New England. And so the answer is that throughout most of the colonies, economics becomes more diverse. There's more ways to make money. You have more people that are doing trades, you know, like cobblers and things like that, than ever before. It's not nearly as limited in terms of the economic choices that you had. Now, in the plantation colonies and cash crop areas, that's not the case. We're still growing almost everything and making almost all of our money through the cash crops. All right, so let's go back to the questions again here. So we can keep on keeping on, maybe. Good Lord. All right. What were the major religions practiced in the 18th century colonies, and where were they strongest? How was it different than in the 17th? Again, just like economics, religion becomes much more diverse. For that matter, so did ethnicity. We start to get more ethnicities. We start to get, you know, back to number 14 for a second. It's not just English people anymore. We're going to start to see more Europeans coming into the colonies in the 18th century. Places like Germany, right? We have the Scots-Irish that we're going to talk about tomorrow. We have Irish immigrants for the first time. Obviously, we're having a major increase in African slavery as well. So in the 18th century, the colonies are much more diverse ethnically than they had ever been before. So ethnically, their population is larger. Ethnically, they're much more mixed. Economically, they're much more diverse, which means there's a lot more activities going on than there were before. And then religiously, it's a lot more diverse. Now, we still have the dominant churches, like the Puritans or the Congregationals up in New England, like the Quakers in the Middle Colonies, like the Anglican Church in the South. But especially after the Great Awakening, we start to see many new religions pop up. We start to see them become more popular. And so we start to see a lot more religious mix than it ever existed before. All right. Number 17, what was the religious atmosphere like in the colonies before the Great Awakening? It was dying out. Religion was nowhere near as important as it had been previously. There was great fear amongst many churches that the colonies were going to become non-religious, or where religion just wasn't a significant factor anymore in everyday life. And so there's great concern, which leads us to number 18. What was the Great Awakening and what were its major effects and who were the most famous leaders associated with it? The Great Awakening is this religious revival that occurs, that spreads throughout the colonies in the 1730s. What were its major effects? Well, it leads to new churches being founded. It leads to splits in some churches that had already existed, which meant they lost some of their strength or some of their numbers. We develop new religions that are generally a little easier to practice. They're not as harsh. They're not as strict. Baptists are a good example of that. Methodists are another faith that becomes popular in the colonies. Who were the most famous religious? Oh, other major effects. It leads to the development of a number of new colleges and universities. Remember, the Great Awakening was about old lights versus new lights. Old lights were the traditional churches and traditional ministers who did the same ministries that they had done 100 years before. They were kind of slow. They were kind of boring. They were kind of monotonous. Whereas new lights used emotion. They used a lot more kind of fiery language to try to rile people up and rev them up. The idea was to make church a lot more of an experience that would attract people to come to it. Also, many of the new faiths that developed, the new light faiths that developed in the colonies, they weren't strict in terms of the requirements to be a member. So again, the Great Awakening is this religious revival. It's really between old churches and new ones. It leads to conflict between them over membership and who can recruit the most members. It makes the country or the colonies much more religious again. So it kind of breathes religious life back into the colonies again. And it leads to new churches being founded. It leads to new colleges and universities being developed. Who are the most famous religious leaders? So we generally like to say there are two. Jonathan Edwards was a really famous religious leader who's credited with kind of starting it. He is a minister in New England, and he's one that really kind of tries to use some of these new methods to attract people for the first time. He used a lot of fear and intimidation. His most famous work is something called Sinners in the Hands of an Angry God, where he talks basically about how we're all dangling over the pits of hell. And what we do is really going to determine whether we are going to hell or not. So he basically says, hey, it's a moment of truth, and we better start becoming religious or else. Others start to copy his sermons as more and more people come out to listen to his fiery speeches. Eventually, the most famous member that you need to know is a guy named George Whitefield. Whitefield was actually English. He comes over to the colonies, and he's almost like a rock star. He travels from colony to colony, kind of riling people up, revving them up, making them super religious, converting people on the spot who would come up to him in droves because he inspired so much emotion. And so we're appealing more to the hearts here after the Great Awakening, religious leaders are, as opposed to maybe appealing to the head, as was the case previously. If you're about a religious experience where you're, you know, singing and dancing and clapping, you're more of a new light because those were the ideas and the methods that became popular during that time. Number 19, what was the British mercantilist system? What was it designed to do to the American colonies? We know what mercantilism is. Mercantilism is when the mother country, in this case England, has absolute control over the colonies, and everything that the colonies produces is designed to support the mother country's economy back home. So generally what you do is you use the resources that exist in colonies and you send them back to England. For the American colonies, the resources were cash crops, right? They were furs, they were lumber, they were rice, you know, whatever products were needed back in England that could make the most profit. The thing is with mercantilism, you don't want to build your colonies up too much where they make the goods themselves. You would like for them to send the resources back to the mother country. Because if the colonies are able to make the products themselves, they're not going to need the mother country anymore, and they'd be more willing to separate or rebel against mother country rules. All right. In addition to that, the other part of mercantilism is if you require your colonies to buy all their products from you so that you can not only get rich off the resources the colony sends back to you, but you also get doubly rich when you turn around and turn those resources into finished products that you force or require your colonists to buy from. All right. Number 20, what were the Navigation Acts and why were they created to help British enforce mercantilism? So there is great concern in England, and rightfully so, that Americans are not buying their products from Britain, that they're smuggling or buying goods from France, from the Dutch. The colonists were far away from England, and they were interested in buying goods that were the cheapest to them. And so they oftentimes would rather buy from the French or from somebody else who would give them a better deal. And so the Navigation Acts, or Navigation Laws, were designed to force American colonists to send all of their goods back to England, to not be able to produce any of the goods themselves, and then to be forced to buy the goods from English merchants as well. So again, the Navigation Act, or laws, and there were a number of them. There was something called the Hat Act. There was something called the Molasses Act. Each of them was supposed to force colonists to send those products back and to buy them from England. They were designed to enforce the British mercantilist system that we just talked about in number 19. So the Navigation Acts are those laws. Number 21, what was salutary neglect and how did it undermine British mercantilism? So Americans don't follow the laws. They smuggle. They keep smuggling. And interestingly enough, there was a government in England at the time that actually didn't care that much that Americans were smuggling. Because the American economy was booming and a lot of that tax money and revenue was coming back to England anyways, some people in the British government supported a system that known as salutary neglect, where they intentionally did not enforce their navigation laws. They didn't want to anger the colonists. They didn't want to frustrate the colonists. And they were already making so much money off of the colonists that they didn't want to cause problems. So the British passed the Navigation Acts, right, in order to enforce their mercantilist system. And then they turned around, and some of the time they didn't actually enforce the laws that they had passed because they did not think it was necessary. It was usually conservatives in the government, so the British government would change a lot. And when conservative governments took over in Britain, they usually did not enforce them because they didn't want to hurt business. They didn't want to really mess with the relations they had with the Americans. What types of American smuggling developed during salutary neglect? The Americans developed something called triangular trade, where they would smuggle goods out of England, or they would skip England, and they would buy and sell goods in the Caribbean, in French islands or Dutch islands or even Spanish islands. They would sometimes, Americans would go and pick up slaves themselves in Africa rather than drop off their cargoes in England and then go down to Africa after that. So the Americans developed a triangular trade system intentionally to get around the Navigation Acts, where they would smuggle goods, which meant illegally buy and sell them in the Caribbean. And in some cases, they would actually import slaves themselves. Finally, number 22, what were the circumstances of the Zenger trial and what effects did it have? It's a real Zenger of a story. Ching. The Zenger trial was when John Peter Zenger was a newspaper publisher in New York. He was critical of the government, the colonial government of New York, and specifically the governor. They arrested him, and they put him on trial. And a lot like Anne Hutchinson, if you remember, the famous dissident in Massachusetts, they wanted to find him guilty so that they could use him as an example. Don't criticize the government, don't criticize the governor, or else this will happen to you. Instead, what happened in the Zenger trial is the attorney for Zenger, a guy whose last name was Adams, was able to convince the court to give him a trial by jury. And what happened was, since it was a trial by jury of his fellow New Yorkers, they ended up finding him not guilty because his argument was essentially that he was printing the truth. All right, so they were trying to bust him for libel, which meant for spreading lies about a political figure. He argued, I'm telling the truth, first off. Secondly, that I'm trying to be made an example of. Ultimately, the jury agreed with him, and so he was acquitted. This was very unusual just because most of the time prior to that, when people were put on trial by the church, or I'm sorry, by the government, they were almost always found guilty because judges were brought in from England or from Canada to make sure that guilty verdicts occurred. What effect does it have in the colonies? It leads to a precedent of freedom of the press, freedom of the media. Obviously, that's going to be another major part of American democracy. And we look back and say, hey, where's the first example that we see this freedom taking place? Well, the answer was the Zenger trial in New York in the late 1730s, early 1740s, a famous example of freedom of the press that we carry on all the way till today. Although there might be some people in our government who might not be really supportive of it right now, if you follow the news at all on a regular basis. All right, folks, that is it. Those are the 22 questions that you really must need to know. I'm not saying that the questions on the exam are going to come directly from those, but they're important concepts and important terms that you ought need to know to give you the best chance for success on Monday. Hey, it's Mr. M. I hope this was helpful to you, and if you have any questions, you better be contacting me on Remind, if not today, if not tomorrow, then over the weekend, because we got a big exam on Monday. Ready or not, Mr. M is here to help you. Any questions, let me know. Until then, folks, it's Mr. M signing off.